In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, God is one.
Amen. Amen.
Discretion being the better part of God. The Feast of the Most Holy Trinity we celebrate today. And we worship the Holy Trinity and the Unity. And this is built into the language that we use, and even to some extent determines the choice of liturgical language, which is not mandated, we would say, is not a matter of, it is not illegitimate to use a modern version of a language, but using a more traditional version of a language that still the people understand is in some jurisdictions the expectation. I don't know if that was clear. That we use liturgical English, prayer book biblical English, or also use Arabic or Greek or what have you, instead of using street English for the worship of God, although when we are talking directly to God in our homes, we can speak to Him just as we would speak to one another. We can always do that. And why would that be the case? And one of the reasons is that we can say things in more traditional languages that are just not clear in a contemporary language, because there's always this degree of degradation. And some of you have heard me say this, you know, perhaps ad nauseum, but I'll keep saying it anyway, no fear, is that in modern languages, except for in the South, where we have the continuation of the use of y'all, which is actually ye all, elided, ye all. It's not clear when you say you, whether you mean one person, or two people, or a room full of people. But in liturgical English, you is always plural. And we would use thee and thou for the singular. But you will notice if you go back through these prayers that we address God the Holy Trinity as thee and thou. Even when we have just talked about God being Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we will address all three in the singular, because all three are unity, all three are one, because God is one. Don't let any Muslim or anybody else tell you, or any oneness Pentecostal or anyone of that ilk tell you that the Trinity is somehow polytheistic. We worship one God, and it's built into the very language that we use for worshiping God, into the very language that we choose to use and how we worship it. We worship, somebody said one time, we don't believe that God is three in one. We believe that God is one in three, that He is unity above all else, and there is always Trinity in the unity. But He is unity. Okay. And in the three are all one. So, in the gospel that is given for the, well, in the, what is given in place of the epistle is from the Revelation of St. John. And you know that in the East, that this is such a sort of esoteric writing that it was almost not included in the list of the scriptures. It was certainly regarded as holy, as sacred, but in the Eastern lectionary, it's not even read in church. It is in the West, obviously here. And there's a description of heavenly worship that is given. A description of heaven. We have how many elders worshiping God? 24 elders. There are 24 because 24, the Revelation is always going to make you do some math. You know, if you don't like math, don't read the Bible. That's not true. Read the Bible anyway. Just get used to doing math. 24 is 12 and 12. So you have 12 apostles, but you have 12 tribes of Israel. And so all the faithful in Israel, preparing for the coming of Christ, and all the Christians following the teachings of the apostles. It's not talking about 12 individual people. It's talking about all the people led by them. Okay? Led by them to worship the one true God who is Trinity. Okay? And here it's Christ enthroned in glory, and they're worshiping him. Okay? And when they're surrounded by four beasts, we have four authors of the Gospels. Okay, so those who believe in the four Gospels about our Lord. And when they say what Isaiah the prophet heard when he had his heavenly vision in the book of the prophet Isaiah, he saw the smoke. Well, we saw the smoke today, didn't we? Smell the smoke, saw the smoke. The doorposts in the temple, and heard proclaim, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come." We sing that, don't we? Holy, holy, holy. Sanctus, sanctus, sanctus. Because God is very, very, very holy, and because Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Holy. Okay. The Trinity is found throughout the Old Testament, but it's under a veil. Okay. God said, "Let us make man in our image." And God is holy, 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 and as our prophet. And the three angels representing God came and sat down with Abraham. Okay. It's an image and a foreshadowing of the full revelation of God's Trinity. And so the Trinity is in the Old Testament. Christ is all throughout the entire Old Testament. We'll be talking about that. We'll be, again, as we do every time when we teach our catechism classes, I wanted to have a meeting of those that we had one chrismation today. Glory to God for this. And again, welcome home. Judy, yes, welcome home. And there will be more because there were quite a few people in this class. We just haven't gotten the chrismations organized yet, just a couple things left to do in preparation for the other chrismations, so expect to see more. And we have people that are going to be part of a new catechism class, and I wanted to meet with them this morning. There aren't as many here as there will be today. So either this Saturday or the next Saturday, start meeting at 10:30 in the morning for the next round of catechism classes. But one of the things that we always go over is Christ throughout the Old Testament. Seeing Christ in the miracles of God in the Old Testament, in the flood, in the Tower of Babel, in Abraham's willingness to sacrifice his son, in David and the temple and the Psalms, and the tabernacle and the song, and Solomon in the temple, and all of these, and preparing for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but him already appearing before his incarnation in the Old Testament as well as the Holy Spirit. But these realities were revealed in the Old Testament under a veil. And so it is said rightly that the Old Testament is the New Testament veiled, and the New Testament is the Old Testament unveiled. The veil is taken away, and we see clearly. The four beasts, each of them had six wings about them. They were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, which was and is and is to come, and they give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne and liveth forever and ever. And whenever they do this and give thanks to the one who sits on the throne forever and ever, the elders fall down before him that sat on the throne and worship him, and they cast their crowns before him. You see that literally in the worship of the Orthodox Church, when the bishops and the priests and the monks take off their berettas or whatever they call it in their own liturgical tradition and bow at the mention of the Holy Trinity and at the mention of the name of Jesus, the elders are taking off their crowns and bowing before God as he is praised. This is literal stuff here about the worship that takes place in the kingdom of God. Okay, this is not, it's poetic, but it's not just poetic. Okay, this is what we experience in real life in the church. And people talk about the book of Revelation, it's really the revelation of St. John, but the book of Revelation being strange, and they may come to the Orthodox Church for the first time, and I hope they will, and we encourage them to do so soon. And then they say, well, it was strange. Well, of course it was. The book of Revelation is strange. And so why wouldn't it be strange to experience the worship of the kingdom of heaven for the first time, but keep coming back? So there was a man of the Pharisees in John chapter 3 named Nicodemus. He was a ruler of the Jews. He was afraid of his peers and what they might say, and so he came to meet with Jesus at night. And he said unto him, Teacher, we know that you're a teacher also, come from God. We know you're from God because nobody can do the miracles that you did unless God is with them. So Jesus knew that he didn't have to do a miracle in order to convince them that he was from God or to get them to pay attention. And so he cuts to the chase at least a little bit, takes them to another level, but not the deepest. And he says, truly I say unto you, unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Well, he just, whatever the man had in mind that he was going to say, our Lord just derailed that. Unless you're born again, you can't see the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he's already old? Can he get into his mother's womb again and get born all over again? And Jesus said, truly I say to you, unless a man is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. What is born of flesh is flesh, and what is born of the Spirit is spirit. So don't be surprised that I said, you must be born again. The Spirit blows wherever it will. Or rather, the wind blows wherever it will. Keep in mind, the word for spirit and wind, same word. Spirit, wind, breath. Breath of God. The wind blows where it's going to blow. And the Spirit of God. It blows wherever it wills. And you hear the sound, but you don't know where it's coming from or where it's going. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Unless you're born of water and the Spirit. This is holy baptism. In the baptism of John the Baptist, men and women and presumably children underwent a plunging into the water that was for their own personal repentance and to start life anew. And it was something they could do again and again. And it was a recommitment to following God. But it was not something that inherently transformed them. It was not something that carried spiritual power in and of itself. it was not energized with the Holy Spirit. Whereas when Christ entered into the waters, he changed everything. So that now when we are baptized with water in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, these waters have the power to transform us. Not because water is somehow magical, but because the Holy Spirit chooses to work through material things to change us who are made of matter. Because that's how God made us. We're the connection. He made us to be the connection between the spiritual and the material world. And so he uses sacraments, spirit acting through matter, to transform us and to bring us closer to him. And unless we are born of water and of spirit, we cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So our Lord is speaking here of holy baptism, the completion of which is holy chrismation through the anointing with oil to be sealed with the Holy Spirit. Okay. A group that was being received as a large body into the Antiochian church and come from a Pentecostal background was asking Paul and Philip, the blessed memory, you know, we always believed that we had received already the Holy Spirit, and yet we're about to be chrismated to receive the Holy Spirit. Can you explain that to us? And he said to them, you have the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit has brought you here. And now he is going to be in you. Not just with you, but in you. Just as our Lord said to his disciples, the Holy Spirit will come who is with you before his ascension and resurrection. The Holy Spirit who is with you will be in you after I ascend. So when the Spirit goes wherever he wants, there's no accounting who's going to show up to follow God. And what the Holy Spirit has been doing in his life to bring him to the point where now the Spirit can be not just with him, but in him. And Jesus said to him, if I have told you earthly things and you believe not, how shall you believe if I tell you of heavenly things? All this time talking of baptism and Nicodemus being amazed and not understanding, our Lord says, he was still talking about earthly things because there's more. There are heavenly things that are more profound or higher, either way it's the same, deeper or higher. That, yes, our sins were washed away in baptism. Yes, in baptism, God comes to dwell in us, and we are united with him by the Holy Spirit and sealed by the Holy Spirit in our relationship with God. But there is more. That God will feed us his own body and blood, feed us with his own life. And as a priest says before receiving communion, I will take the bread of heaven and call upon the name of the Lord. What reward shall I give unto the Lord for all the benefits that he hath done unto me? I will call upon the name of the Lord. That in praying the rosary and the Jesus prayer, God comes to dwell in our hearts and we are united with him yet more deeply, along with our being united with them in the Holy Communion. And these twin mysteries take us deeper and deeper, if we allow them to, into union with God and communion with one another. So we say at the end of Baptism, as we did this morning and every morning we pray, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all as we're united with Christ in his humanity. We are united with his divinity. And being so joined to him, we are joined in the life of the Holy Trinity, which is incomprehensible and practically unspeakable. And yet that mystery is true. And these are the heavenly things that are almost impossible for us to speak of. And yet, great is their power, and they transform our lives. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, God is one.
Amen. Amen.